And in general, what is the value of preserving studios of artists? What are the issues involved in doing this? Alan Campbell is the manager and curator of the oldest surviving artist studio in Australia, that of the landscape painter Hans Heisen. Although Heisen is most famous for painting gum trees, the property where he lived and worked is called The Cedars. It's in Harndorf in the Adelaide Hills, and it's open to the public. And Barry Pearce is the Emeritus Curator of Australian Art at the Art Gallery of New South Wales. Alan, The Cedars was Hans Heisen's house and studio from when he built it in 1912 till his death in 1968. It's also where his daughter, Nora Heisen, painted. Her studio is there as well. First of all, can you just tell us about his actual studio?
To repeat your terminology, it's a glorious studio, a wonderful example of Federation arts and crafts, architecture and building materials, beautiful, beautiful condition.
What's in it?
The family's philosophy is if Sir Hans was to walk into his studio tomorrow, he'd pick up the brushes and resume painting and not realise there's been any, or not notice any changes at all, which is part of its uniqueness, is its wonderful intactness. And everything's still there, you know, from his brushes, his charcoals, his canvases, etching press. It's quite unique in that it's been preserved in such wonderful intactness for such a period of time.
Well, the property is still owned privately by the family, by Hans Heisen's grandchildren now, which I think is also about to change. But what are the challenges and issues for keeping it open and operating as a memorial, as a museum, year in, year out?
The biggest charm of it is the family presence. The family don't live there. They live in Adelaide, but the beauty of Adelaide, you know, they're up the freeway in 15 minutes and all their entertainment, etc., is held still on the property. It's been open to the public for the last, since 1994. The big bogey, the big handicap, unfortunately, is also the private ownership because it effectively negates funding. People assume it gets great dollops of supporting money, which it doesn't. Until that changes, you know, we're finding it increasingly more difficult to keep it financially buoyant. For the last 20 years, it's been maintained by the grandchildren. Sir Hans, when he died, they had eight children. He left it specifically to the eldest son. David Heisen, he maintained it for the 20 years until he died and then left it to his four children, who have continued that service and, as I say, open it to the nation in 94. When I say grandchildren, these grandchildren are now into their 60s, entering their early 70s, Amanda, and ownership was to pass to the next generation of the Heisen family. But the family, I think, have made a very wise decision. It's a matter of, you know, does it belong to the family or does it belong to the nation?
Yes, so what are the plans for the future?
A foundation, a charitable trust. This is in legal hands, been set up. We hope it'll be in place within a matter of months, where the family will, in effect, relinquish ownership, but with the establishment of the foundation, looking particularly at corporate-private benefactor support, because it's, you know, it's such a national treasure, it's got to be preserved and protected for the nation.
Well, Barry Pearce, in general, what do you think is the impulse to preserve an artist's studio? What's the value of doing that? You know, after all, what they really leave behind is their art, isn't it? That's really what it's all about.
Well, it's an interesting, it's a very interesting question because it varies from one artist to another and the nature of the benefaction of what's left behind. I mean, a lot of artist museums exist, and there are many in Paris, and there are quite a few in Europe generally. There's not so many in Australia, unfortunately. But some of them have actually been corrupted, and they've moved away from the sense of being the domicile of the artist and the sense of where the artist worked. I'm not so interested in those. I love the Heisen Artist Museum because I think you go there and you almost feel that Heisen himself just walked out, went out for a country walk and he'll be back soon, you know. And I love those kinds of artist museums, but they're not all quite like that. Getting back to your original question, what's the value of, you know, exploring the relics of an artist's life, you know, once they're gone? I'm quite interested in the current thing that still hasn't abated about CSI investigation of crime and archaeology and there's a sense that if we go through an artist's remains or what remains in their studio, we might get a bit of a mystery behind the creation, the secret, the magic.
Yes, I mean, that's what it's all about, isn't it? To get some sense of the inspiration that we might get a clue as to what it was, both as a sort of matter of general curiosity, but also for ourselves.
And I think there are three great artist or writers museums that I know of in the world, I think, that give me that sense that. And one of them is the Heysen in Adelaide, in Harndorf. Another is the Gustave Moreau Museum in Paris, where you just get the sense that he's around the corner and you can smell the paint, you can smell the creativity. And the other one is the Leo Tolstoy Museum in Russia, where again, it's a very generously spaced house and you can walk around the rooms and it's like he just walked away from his writing desk. So those are the greatest ones.
The two key words are preserve it and protect. And another satisfying achievement for us was to do this with Nora Heysen's studio at Harndorf. One of our hopes was we might have been able to open Nora's wonderful old home at Hunters Hill as the studio, where her studio was, in her memory. But the conflict that would have ensued from neighbours, etc., it was going to be World War III, so we, you know, that had to be backed off. Luckily, Nora gave us her blessing to open her studio at Harndorf.
So you transferred the studio from Hunters Hill to Harndorf?
Yeah, although she particularly, in her latter years, she particularly leaned more towards her Harndorf roots, Amanda, and she felt that she would like that to be restored. It took us, you know, 5 years gentle harassment because Nora felt that this was her father's territory and she was loath to encroach. But in the end, she said no, she would give her blessing to the restoration of her studio, which she used from the 1930s. And a wonderful collection of her work has come back as part of her bequest. So I think it's very important, you know, that preservation and overall that protection, because once you lose it, you can never regain it.